Hi, this is Gary with MacMost.com. This is part 7 of my course, The Practical Guide to Mac Security. This course is brought to you free thanks to my great Patreon supporters. Go to MacMost.com/Patreon. There you can read more about the Patreon campaign, join us, and get exclusive content and course discounts. So let's look at virtual private networks. Virtual private networks are also known as VPNs. So what is a VPN? Well, when you use a device like a Mac to access a service on the internet, like a website, a lot of things happen in between your Mac and the website. A simplified look at that would be something like this. You would connect to your Wi-Fi and your data would travel between your Mac and your Wi-Fi. Then it would travel to your ISP, usually through a modem of some sort, a cable modem or DSL modem, some sort of equipment you've got, and then would go to your ISP, your Internet Service Provider. From your Internet Service Provider, it will go out to the Internet where it would go from one router to another, perhaps bouncing around the country or world, until it finally reaches the web server that has the data. And then this works in both ways. So your request would get all the way to the website, and the website would send back the data all the way through that same chain back to your Mac. There are three parts of that that are really out of your control. Let's assume that you trust the website. That's why you're going there. Maybe it's your bank, maybe it's a shopping site, and that you trust your Mac. But those three spots in between could be places where you could be spied on, where your data could be intercepted. Now, if it's your Wi-Fi network, then you're probably not concerned about that. But it could be the Wi-Fi network, say, at a coffee shop, a conference center, a hotel, a school, or some other place. Then also, after it leaves the Wi-Fi equipment, it has to go to the Internet Service Provider. If you're sitting in a coffee shop, the coffee shop is probably not an Internet Service Provider. They probably have contracted out to a cable company or telephone company or some other Internet service for their Internet connection. That's the ISP that they've got. And you don't know who that is. And you don't know whether or not you should trust that. And then from there it goes over the network, and there are lots of points there where you may or may not want to trust that your data is going through there and somebody could see it. And let me point out that it may not be that the organization, for instance a coffee shop, may be the one not to trust. For instance, a coffee shop could be completely harmless, but somebody could have somehow gotten into their Wi-Fi equipment and installed malware in there. So the coffee shop is innocent, but because they're not internet savvy, they haven't secured their Wi-Fi hotspot that they have sitting over the counter that everybody's connected to, and that's been compromised. And now you can't trust the Wi-Fi, not because the coffee shop isn't trustworthy, but because their equipment's been compromised. So a VPN will help you solve this problem. If you install a VPN on your Mac and then you turn it on, then this entire diagram changes to look like this. From your Mac, you've got installed on it a VPN client. It's software running on your Mac, and that's going to encrypt all the data as it leaves your Mac before it goes to the Wi-Fi network. So everything here in red shows where data has been encrypted. So if the Wi-Fi network has been compromised, they're only going to see encrypted data. So it's just going to look like a bunch of scrambled data to them. They can't tell what it is you're doing, where you're going. They can't see any passwords or information at all. It's basically all encrypted through the Wi-Fi network, through the ISP, and most of the way through the internet until it finally reaches the VPN server. So when you buy a client and a server for VPN, the client part is the software that gets installed on your Mac. The server part sits out there. It's the company that you're going through. So if you went through, say, ABC VPN, you would get the ABC VPN client on your Mac, and somewhere out on the internet would be the ABC VPN server, and you'd be connecting directly to that through the Wi-Fi, ISP, and the internet. And at that point, the data would be decrypted, and then it would go back out to the internet and to the website. So you would bypass any problem with the Wi-Fi equipment, any problem with the ISP's equipment, and most of the problems that you might experience out there on the internet. Your data would be traveling, for the most part, as encrypted data that nobody could get to. So what does this protect you from? Well, first, it protects you from bad Wi-Fi networks, but also against bad local network equipment. So the Wi-Fi router could be fine, but the modem, the cable modem or DSL modem sitting behind that, that might be compromised in some way. Using a VPN will protect you from that. And the internet service provider itself, if it's tracking data, for instance, that would just encrypt things as it goes through that internet service provider. So your coffee shop's internet service provider or hotel's internet service provider wouldn't really know what it is you're up to at all and wouldn't be able to intercept or see your data. So what does it not protect you from? Well, there's a big misconception, of course, that install a VPN and now you've secured everything. And that's not true at all, because most things that you're worried about aren't really going to be affected at all. For instance, if the site at the other end is bad, like if you're connecting to a fake site or a site that's trying to steal your data, a VPN is not going to help you. You're still giving your password or information to that site. Malware has nothing to do with malware. You could still download malware from a site you shouldn't trust just as easily over VPN as from anywhere else. VPN is not going to help you. Your online accounts aren't protected by VPNs in any way. So if you have a weak password on your Facebook account, using a VPN on your Mac won't in any way affect that. And any social engineering attack you get, any phishing attack, any link you click on that you shouldn't, any way you're tricked into giving up your password, VPN doesn't help you with that at all. The other thing the VPN doesn't protect you against is the VPN company itself. So it's important if you're going to sign up for a VPN that you trust that company. That company is keeping everything safe. Now there's an alternative to VPNs called SSL. And you probably know SSL more as HTTPS. If you look at a URL, if you're going to a website, you may see http://apple.com. But if you look closely, most websites today say HTTPS, not HTTP. This means it's secured. It's SSL. What SSL does is it encrypts data from your Mac all the way to the website. So basically there's an encryption that's agreed upon between your computer and the website, and the data traveling from your computer all the way through the Wi-Fi, ISP, and all the way through the internet to the web server is all encrypted. If it sounds a lot like VPN, it is. It really does do a lot of the same things. It's actually even more comprehensive than using a VPN. So how does it compare? Well, one of the best things about using SSL is it's automatic. Probably every site you're going to today is using HTTPS. If you try to go to a site like Gmail or Amazon or Facebook or a bank with http://, it's just going to change that to add an S. It's going to automatically connect you securely. The only sites still left around that don't use secure stuff or maybe some old data sites where you're not really logging into them. Maybe you're just going to and there's just, you know, somebody's blog or something like that. Almost every site you go to today where you have to log in, you're doing it over HTTPS. So it's automatic. It's easy. There's nothing you need to do. You're already using it and it's free. It's not costing you anything. Whereas a VPN, usually you pay an annual fee to use a VPN. The only downside to it really is it's not hiding where you're going. If you're going to go to a site like Amazon, then the Wi-Fi network, the ISP, they all know that you're going to Amazon.com. They don't know what data you're sending back and forth between Amazon.com. They just know that you're going there. So there's that one little piece of privacy that probably isn't important in most cases. So the question is do you need a VPN? And 10 years ago, that answer may have been, yeah, it's probably a good idea. But today it's a little different. You probably don't need it in 2021. Most users will not need a VPN. It's good for that extra layer of privacy, but it's not necessary for most people. Most of the time you'd be using a VPN, you'd want to do it while traveling. So you'd only be using it a small portion of the time, and probably while traveling you're just doing some basic things like checking your email and a few bits of shopping, things like that, and it's really no need for the privacy there. It's a good extra layer for corporate and government data. I mean, if you work for a company that has a policy that says you must use a VPN, then of course obviously you've got to use it. And if you're dealing with data that has value, like government data may, then they may insist on you having that installed on your Mac or devices. One downside to a VPN that isn't present for SSL is it can make things more difficult. Trying to connect using a hotel's Wi-Fi, for instance, is already problematic in a lot of cases when Wi-Fi is pretty weak or the network is not very good. And adding a VPN to that can make things more difficult. Sometimes you get caught in a loop where, you know, the VPN wants to protect you right away, but in order to connect to the internet, the hotel's Wi-Fi is going to ask you some questions like your room number, name, a password or something, and you're fighting between the VPN wanting to protect you and the hotel saying, wait a minute, we're not going to let you access anything on the internet until you give us some information, and you can't do that when you have a VPN turned on. It can be a real pain, and I've run into situations where I've been at, say, a hotel and their Wi-Fi is so bad that every 5 minutes it seems to disconnect and then reconnect, and then the VPN has to then reconnect, so I end up getting maybe, you know, 4 minutes of good internet connection followed by a minute of downtime while it reconnects to Wi-Fi and then to the VPN. So where do you get a VPN if you still want one? Well, there are tons and tons of companies, and here are some that I've used in the past and tried in the past, but there are so many more. If you search online for best VPNs or, you know, VPN deals or whatever, you'll come up with tons of websites. Some websites that you've never heard of and some that you have, but in both cases, most of the sites that you'll see that say, hey, here's some good VPN, try these, they're getting paid. Keep that in mind. Even if it's a website you know and trust, they're probably getting paid to actually have that link there. So if they say that one VPN is a good one, or here's the top three to use, and there are three links, if you click one of those three links and go to get that VPN service, you've probably given a payday to that site. Now, that's not to say that the VPN is bad. It could be perfectly fine VPN. Matter of fact, all of the ones here at the top that I show probably have those deals out there. Doesn't make them bad VPNs, but it does mean that the review sites necessarily can't be trusted. So keep that in mind. One other thing to keep in mind is most are basically the same. Most VPNs do not have their own network out there. When you saw that diagram early and it showed the VPN server, VPN servers, that's a whole other level. There are companies that offer VPN servers out there. And when you go with a company like ABC VPN, chances are they've purchased time on these VPN servers. So it's not like using one VPN over another is going to give you a fantastic service based, you know, on their service versus another company's service. You're probably going to get the same level of service. So it all comes down to their little apps for Mac and their apps for the iPhone and how well they work and, you know, how cool their little features are where you can choose a VPN in your local area or one based on a country or something like that. It's really pretty much the same type of service you're going to get no matter which VPN you choose. Chances are it doesn't really matter that much which one you choose, and you could usually buy a year's worth of VPN service, install it, and then, you know, the next year maybe there's a better deal from one of the other companies. So now let me show you what it's like to use a VPN service in case you've never used one before.
Typically you would pay for a service on a website just like you would pay for any other service, and then you would download their app and run through their installer, which just, you know, prompts you to install. Is it okay to install it? Enter your password and all of that. And then you end up with something in the menu bar here that gives you access to the VPN service. So in this case, I've installed something called Private Internet Access, and I have an account set up with an annual subscription fee. Now you're going to get controls here, and they're all going to basically be about the same in terms of what you get in the controls, except that they're going to look different. They're all going to have their own little interface and icons and things like that. So you get the little logo here. You get a big on-off switch, which is all that really matters. But typically you also get the ability to choose a location. So I can click here and choose a location. And it's nice to choose one that's nearby. So in this case, they've got servers here in Denver. I'm in Denver. So it's nice for speed that I can connect to a VPN server that is really close. And I can also connect to ones that are further away. I may look to different websites and services like I'm in these locations, because that's what VPN does according to those websites. If I switched here to Texas, it would appear that I'm using a computer that's in Texas. Websites also can get your GPS location. You may see every once in a while a website request your location, and that overrides that. That's your computer saying, yes, I am located in Denver. But, you know, sometimes services will use these, so it's handy to pick a location that's near you for speed and to make sure things that you use will continue to work normally. But if you wanted to, you could pick, say, you know, the United States or US West or something like that, and it would just pick whatever the fastest server is in that country. And you could pick other countries as well if you wanted to appear, you know, further mask your location and make it appear you're somewhere else. Although this may then make things not work very well. If you say, oh yes, I'm in London, but in fact you're in the United States, then your GPS data for visiting a site and the server data may not be the same, and now maybe a website has trouble helping you in some way. So you can play with your location if you want, but you don't necessarily have to get the benefits of using a VPN. And then to turn it on, I just hit this big button here. And that's basically what all the controls are. You know, you subscribe to the service, you just want to turn it on or keep it on. Sometimes there are settings, and in this case, under the settings here, and again, this is going to look different for different services, you can have launch on system startup, connect on launch, so it's all automatic. If you're traveling, you just have it turned on and it's automatically going to be on. Here, I'll turn it on manually. And you can see here, here's my IP address, the real IP address of where I'm really located. And this is the VPN server's IP address. So going back to that diagram, this is my computer. This is that VPN server way out there. So everything thinks I'm here. But in fact, then all the data is going through the VPN service to me. So that's part of the protection there. And then while I've got this on, I look like I'm here. And that's about it. Everything then is encrypted between me and the VPN service. And you know, as long as I have it on, it's going to work like that for any network traffic I've got. But I can then just turn it off here to disconnect and go back to just using the internet regularly.
If you liked this video, click the thumbs up button below to let me know. I publish new tutorials each weekday. Hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out.